in 3D motion design, working with forward-thinking brands like Hobolt, Microsoft, Mercedes-Benz. Tendril's clients are visionaries, innovators, and imagineers, the brands inventing tomorrow. We have been so lucky to work with Tendril for almost a decade now. They've helped us amplify our brand expression, our craft, our storytelling, and convey the emotion of our products' experiences. We are excited to welcome Tendril to Design Week as they hold a mirror and share reflections on the most memorable creative work and briefs from Microsoft. Welcome, Avel, Leo, and Alex.
Wow, this was so beautiful.
Thank you so much,
Alexis.
Thank you.
All right. Should we get this started? The talk of our presentation is Behind the Scenes, the Future of Designing with Microsoft. And I just wanted to open this and let Alexandre take us through the next few slides.
Hola. Hola, everybody. My name is Alexandre. I'm an ECD and co-founder of Tendril. Extremely excited to be here and to be able to talk a little bit about our journey collaborating with Microsoft. As Alexis was saying, it's been almost a decade. It's been actually like 9 years. And in the last 9 years, we've learned so much from you all. We're constantly looking for ways to improve how we work together. So the opportunity to present today is just like truly amazing. And we're really excited to talk about what are some of the best ways we can collaborate to continue to create inspiring films that touch on like people's heart, that brings that emotional side forward, and as well, any other types of expressions of the future.
Indeed, Shanji, thank you. And my name is Yvel. I'm Design Innovation Director at Tendril. And before we continue, I just want to say thank you to Alexis and Alexei and the whole team behind Design Week for inviting us to join you here.
Yes. And last but not least, in case you haven't seen my face before in any of the Teams calls, my name is Leo Mateus, and I'm also an executive creative director at Tendril. And we thought that to start this off, we really wanted to play a film that really celebrates the awesome collaboration that we've had throughout these years. So why don't we just do that? Me paré, caminé, me subí, me fui contra la corriente y también me perdí, fracasé, me encontré, lo viví y aprendí cuando te pegas fuerte más profundo es el beat, sí. Sigo bailando y escribiendo mis letras, sigo cantando con las puertas abiertas, atravesando por todas estas tierras y no hay que viajar tanto para encontrar la respuesta. Hey, no te preocupes si no te aprueban, cuando te critiquen tú solo di. Soy yo. All right. So thank you so much. Basically, this presentation is all going to be about behind the scenes. It's all going to be under the hood. We're going to be taking a look at our work throughout the year, some of the best examples of our collaboration, but also we're going to be talking about the future of really having Tendril, continuing to having Tendril as a design extension to Microsoft's expressions.
So for those of you who don't know a little bit about Tendril, is that as Alexis mentioned very beautifully at the beginning, Tendril is a global creative studio, and we use design, we use animation and technology to highlight a client's or brand's innovation in the best possible way, in ways that are inspiring, beautiful, and relatable. And we've been around for a while. We've been around for 13 plus years. We have two offices. One, our main office, our main hub is in Toronto, and our second location is in São Paulo, where Alexandre has been spearheading things for about a year and a half. And we're just about 70 plus people in those two locations. And since the very beginning, one really interesting thing about Tendril is that we've always strived to make the best possible imagery. And once that is combined with visual poetry or visual abstraction in the sense of story, it would then become films for Microsoft, or become a sequence of stills, lately design systems, as well as digital content for physical installations, as well as digital spaces, such as virtual galleries or even the metaverse. And throughout the years, we've also realized something, that most of that innovation actually happens on your side. It happens on the Microsoft side. When you release a new app, when you release a new device, something that changes our day-to-day lives. And we're merely the conduits to that message. And our work really is to find that pure signal, the one that really translates into emotion to viewers, consumers, and enthusiasts of Microsoft. And now I'm just going to let Shanji take us through a little bit of that backstory.
Thanks so much, Leo. Yeah, it's really hard to believe that it's been 9 years since the very first moment that we're first contacted by Microsoft to work on a very first collaboration, which we're looking here. In this case, we're talking about visualizing the technology behind the HoloLens. Back then, as we worked together, trying to bring some of these like few AR experiences into life, it was also the beginning of building, you know, a very beautiful relationship. What we see here are some, you know, pictures that I personally took from some of my visits at the campus. I have some very fond memories from those times. I want to draw your attention to me and my hand very proudly holding the paper cup, you know, with water inside with the Microsoft logo on it. Great memories. And shortly after the HoloLens collab, then came your Fluent Design announcement around 2016. It was an extremely exciting moment. And once again, we were the lucky ones who got the extremely rare opportunity to kickstart the visualization of these five pillars that we see here, the five pillars that compose the principles around Microsoft's Fluent Design language. Now, if fast forward into present day, we took the liberty to go to an Instagram account and grab this snapshot, because honestly, it is extremely inspiring to scroll down and see all this amazing evolution around all of your brand expressions. Without a doubt, I think we can all agree that you guys have been able to spark so much creativity and inspired so many people around the world. It really amazes us to see how vibrant this community is.
Well, it's really apt that the theme this year is co-evolution, because our working relationship with you has spanned over the creation of 20 plus films, 50 plus AR filters, 2,000 plus emojis, for those of you who know, wallpapers, character explorations, and more. And what I love most about this is that this is part of the larger Microsoft expression. Our work really amplifies these elements. It's alive with emotion, it radiates positivity, and illuminates hope and desire. And as we continue the collaboration, I'd like to also note that much of our internal processes at Tendril have been honed and created and structured in service of creating this body of work. I'll give you a brief overview of what these processes are. So at the very beginning of every journey, before we kick off a production, we'd like to explain to our partners how we might collaborate within each phase of development for a project. Usually this comes in the form of a framework that best suits the goals, the deliverables, and timelines and budget. And what happens is that quite often we kick off with the research and concept phase. And it sits at the very beginning and the foundations and the core principles of the piece of communication that we're about to explore. And here we engage deeply with the product or service and the challenge we're about to sort of embark on, and uncover, or try to uncover at least, the real reasons why it exists in the world, and also why anyone else should care. We usually conduct workshops, interviews, and chats with the designers and the engineers, and to sort of figure out what their core motivations are. And this is all also in parallel to maintaining a macro perspective of what's happening in the wider landscape of the product or service that we're exploring, because it's always good to know what else is happening. And upon all that, we take all that, the data, the insights, the musings, and map out the visual concepts that align most with the intent and hone in on the most viable metaphors to expand on. And all this through the lens of best-in-class design. And then we move on to the next phase, which is once we're in agreement with the overall concepts and themes, we get into shaping the specific ideas. So here we draw upon our expansive design experience, the techniques and the practices to land on the most suitable medium to achieve the goal. Here we outline the narrative and the design expressions best suited. And usually at this stage, you know, things like storyboards, user journeys, art direction, and the specific deliverables get defined. And this is also when sometimes people like to conduct user research just to see if this is on the right track. And then at the final stage, you know, once all of that is agreed, we're now fully immersed in the project. We know inside out how to talk about it, how to talk about the service, and what are we trying to express here. The real fun begins. This is the phase when the most beautiful pictures, the clever motion sequences, and the gorgeous renders get made. Usually at this time, the team expands quite a bit, and everyone's working in sync with weekly check-ins and also reviewing that we're still on track with the original intent. And, you know, you might sort of see now this is quite a lot of process that we go through to achieve a result here. And yes, it is quite a lot, but we've really sort of found out that this is the best way to get the most out of our collaboration. Now, I'd like to also point out that not every project has to go through every single step of the process that's outlined here, you know, because quite often I'm amazed and humbled by the exceptional talent and innovations that our clients have and bring. A lot of the times the thinking is already there and we get called upon just to do the design expression part. And that's really fun. We love to jump in right in, like in that too. And now I'll hand over to Shanji to take you through a project that actually took us through every single stage of this process I've outlined. And you can see the outcome of each stage for yourself.
Correct. Thank you so much, Val. So we're going to be talking about Microsoft Vision 365. We chose this one not only because we think that it's a gorgeous film, but it's also a project that tells really well our creative process. basically what Yvel just walked us through it. There's so much that we love about this very inspiring film. So we thought that would be really great to take a deep dive and see how we brought it to life. So first things first, you know, is the brief. And in this case, the brief that we received from you. And Microsoft, through the brief, expressed a very forward-looking perspective, envisioning a future that was characterized by a few things such as brightness, intelligence, and connectivity. And that then suggested to us that you wanted a film that not only reflect on past accomplishments, but also inspire excitement and a lot of anticipation for everything that lies ahead. So this was also the very first time that Microsoft was introducing the cloud functionality across Office 365. And on top of that, giving it the fluent design treatment. So as we can see here, there was a substantial amount of key objectives that we had to unpack within this Anthem film, right? So after receiving the brief, we started phase one, which comprises of research and concept. At this very important stage, what we normally do, and we did, we spent loads of time collecting, filtering all kinds of relevant materials for the film, for the project. Another thing that will happen during this stage is that we'll be constantly speaking with stakeholders on the client side, just to make sure that we're fully capturing the objectives from the brief. And another interesting thing that will come through this process is that we'll start like opening some doors that the team on the other side didn't consider before. So from this exchange of information, we'll start defining some of the very important characteristics of the film, represented here in the form of keywords. And from the keywords, we start the concepting phase. And this is where we start essentially identifying some of the creative challenges and some technical ones too. So speaking of creative challenges, let's talk about these two here, the cloud and connected spaces. We chose to talk about these two because we think that they're a very solid pillars for the film. And the images you see here as well are from a very initial set of visual references that we collected and we presented back to you guys. So about the clouds, as you can see here on the top left image, at the very beginning, we did consider starting and designing a cloud that was going to feel very much like a derivative. Or a solution. But thankfully, because we're starting to film on phase one, we have this like very nice runway that allows us to have enough time to keep brainstorming about the important features of this very, very unique cloud. And as a result of that, when you see the other images, you can see that we started drifting away from the real cloud idea and switching into more abstract versions of it. So after a lot of exploration and back and forth, we managed to settle on what you see here, very futuristic and inspiring look. We definitely wanted the cloud to feel extremely fluid and kind of have like some magical properties, if you will, you know, if you think about like a magic tapestry of data, for example, right? So now switching to the connected spaces, we knew connected spaces were also key to showcasing some important qualities of what you wanted to convey, in this case, productivity and collaboration. And you wanted to do this in a very seamless and dynamic way. So based on that premise, we started developing the designs that we see here. I want to bring your attention to the fact that you can see that due to the fact that we wanted to create a very fluid feel by not having any hard lines, walls, or doors separating the outside environment from the interior, it just gives the sense of, you know, a very vast world. And we didn't stop there. We kept developing this concept a little bit further in order to enhance what I just said, because we really wanted to give it this obstacle-free feeling. And we achieved that by essentially letting the sand and the vegetation from the outside environment grow inside the interior walls. I have to say that obviously it was very carefully designed because we didn't want to give the impression that nature was claiming everything back from us, but rather we really wanted to depict this harmony between humans and nature. So when you combine all of this stuff, we really wanted the viewer to have a greater sense of freedom and immersiveness, as you can see here. We also wanted the viewer to get a sense of limitless possibilities. It's like we're not really constrained inside a box. As I was saying before, it's supposed to really feel like a vast world without borders or any kind of limitation. On the technical side of things, let's talk about that. The film required incorporating humanity. It's something that is very recurrent. And we wanted to achieve that in the form, in this case, in particular, in the form of showing human hands interacting with the apps. And to overcome like some budget constraints, we decided internally that we're approaching this by creating CGI hands instead of live action shots. I have to say, I still have memories of navigating this. It was a very difficult challenge because hands have lots of details and imperfection, right? When you hold your hand in front of you, you can see all the different kinds of subtleties in motion. So in order to do that, you can see on the bottom right of the screen, we developed and created this robust rig inside Maya. In the end, we achieved, a relatively decent result of animation and the look and feel felt like quite good. However, we weren't fully satisfied. We decided to keep perfecting the CGI hands for future projects. And as a result of that, we have made the 3D hands, turn them into a very versatile and universally used asset for the entire studio across multiple projects. So as we can see, there are lots of interesting beneficial outcomes that a project of this scale can provide, right? To us, internally at Tendril, we feel that we're constantly being reminded that we're playing the infinite game here. There's always a need and a desire to do better next time. So of course, alongside, the stuff that we just discussed, we start focusing as well on the story beats because we need to start laying out the foundation of the film, right? So over here, what we're looking at is essentially the bones of a film taking shape. And we love doing this because it's a very quick and efficient way to get a bunch of the core ideas for the team on the other side to review. And it's also at this stage where we really have to pay close attention to make sure that we can strike a balance between brand expression and product truth. These two things are you know, need to walk side by side, and it's a very fine dance that we have to do. And of course, like it happens only because of your help and support. So after the story beats are locked in, then we move into the next phase of a project. So now we're entering the phase two, the developing the idea. And is at this stage that we're devoting lots of time sketching on paper and designing 3D. We try to produce a huge, huge amount of visual materials. But one important thing here is that as we're doing this, we cannot forget that whatever we create here, it needs to be a direct reflection and be in alignment with all the stuff that we discussed and discovered like on a previous phase. So the selection of images that are here, they tell us a few things, but I want to call one very important component that is happening here, that it's about world building. World building is crucial because we think that it's really important to imagine an entire world that it's ready to be explored. So although the image that we see here, they're not in the film, I can assure you that they're there. They belong to the universe that we created. And it's really important. It really is. Here we can see how we wanted to basically design accessories and some bespoke furniture pieces that took lots of cues from the Microsoft universe of apps. We've also tried to add lots of imperfection for the scenes just to make sure that they felt like lived in. So when you look at some of the images, you can see the rugs have wrinkles, furnitures are not perfectly aligned. So it's really, really key. And as I was saying a moment ago, start loose sketches before diving into 3D. And I just want to say that the sketches, they don't need to be award-winning worthy sketches, because what's really important to us is that this is just a very important design exercise and a great way for bringing everyone to sit around the table, you know, and have some very productive creative jams. If I remember correctly, this project took place around like a month or two before, you know, COVID hit us really hard. We've adapted, you know, since COVID. And nowadays we use a mix of digital tools to achieve a similar result. But occasionally we're really trying our very best to still go back and sit around the physical table and have these creative jams. So after the sketch, the column you see in the middle, it's the moment when each one of us will go to our workstation and start producing style frames. To the right, another important thing to highlight here is, as you know, we're deep in this process of designing and imagining how everything is going to come together, we also try to identify shots that will require complex motion or simulations. And this is when, you know, internally, we'll bring someone like Houdini artist to start on some R&D at a very early stage. Once again, speaking of world building, this is a shelf inside, you know, one of the rooms that we don't see in the film. But again, it exists. It's really there. We created a range of plants and exotic flowers to populate this universe. More plants and stones that we see here, a right amount of rocks. Nothing that we created to this universe is generic. We really want our world to feel quite authentic and special. Next over here, we played around with landscapes. In this case, we try different moves, like the dunes you see on an upper row. And at the bottom part of the screen here, we tried out different visual ways to represent the Microsoft logo in the scene. The goal we had in mind was to portray the squares that we see here, like think of them as powerful relics. And when they get together and they form the logo, they're supposed to create this portal to an amazing world, a world of infinite possibilities. That was the intention that we had in mind. So over here, it's all about representing data, and it's something that we have a lot of fun exploring, especially when we have a chance to do this using abstract metaphors. It's something that we have a lot of fun. So as you can see here in the early exploration days, we really played around with the idea that these data sets, so to speak, are actually, think of them as real objects inhabiting the physical world, right? We thought that would be really nice and a great way to inspire the users to imagine their precious data as real tangible objects that they can manipulate and play around with, right? So let's talk about storyboard, because we need to start defining the shot sequences by drawing one, right? So this moment is another milestone in the project as we're reaching the end of phase two. And from here, we're entering the last phase of the project, phase three. So the way it goes is that once we have the storyboards or the storyboard locked in with your approval, we start generating final style frames while also starting to animate the shots. From there, we have a dedicated team who start the lighting and texturing. This is a place where ton of attention to the details goes into. It's really key to have a dedicated team able to do that. And then at some point we start rendering the sequences using our in-house render farm. It's something that we've been building, this capability we've been building for, you know, over a few years. And we think it's very important to have that capability in house. It does make a big, big, massive difference in the end. Just sharing some more final frames from the film here. So once we have the rendered sequences, those sequences would then be passed along to the compositing team. And the compositing team will start the what we call the assembly process, right? And here's another QC point of control for us. Believe it or not, we go frame by frame to make sure that we're glitch free, because these scenes are really heavy and there's a lot of versionings that, you know, we produce just until we can iron all the kinks, right? And during the nuke compositing stages, also when we pay very close attention to make sure that the film has a cohesive look and feel, right? So from here, you might be, you know, imagining that what comes next. And if you think that it's the delivery day, you are absolutely right, because from here, it's all about, you know, shipping this labor of love to our clients. Just included this slide here because, of course, we can't forget about all the love and care that goes into sound design. We always work in tandem with the music partner to ensure that the music score is another special component of a film such as this one. We know that the sound design is, as we just watched, right, it's what often sets the mood and brings the emotional side of the film forward. And we really care about striking a very strong chord when it comes to the emotional side of things. It really is the other half of the story, right? So just want to say a big thanks to Zelig in this case for another strong partnership. They never cease to amaze us. They're amazing partners, and it's just it blows our minds, like, you know, how much they of this like artistic sensibility that they have. So yeah, thanks to Zelig. So this is just, we're almost there. Just wanted to, you know, very quickly recap what we just went through, right? We showed to you guys the three different phases. Oops. The three different phases that we have to join a project. And in the specific case of Microsoft's Vision 365, it's really important to say how much this project benefited from starting with research. You know, you saw how much effort and energy went into that stage, to then move into the developing of the idea, and to finally, of course, getting to the production. It's our most powerful way of collaborating. Before I pass the mic to my friend Leo here, just would like to take a quick moment to look at these comments that we grabbed from Microsoft social media channels. I just want to, you know, bring your attention here to some of the keywords used by these very kind humans. You see words such as inspiring, future, dream. These are all things that during phase one of the project we defined, right? Those were like the foundation of the project. So it's really nice to see them materialized here, that the people, that's kind of how they felt. Again, right? It's about the feelings. We do love spending time reading people's reaction to all the visual expressions that we create. But obviously, we also know that there are lots of different ways of measuring the success of a campaign. But to us, you know, these comments are real, like a testament of all the care and all the love that we dedicate to our projects. It really is. So Leo, please take it away.
Thank you so much, Shanji. That was really, really inspiring and beautiful. So as a segue to Microsoft Vision 365, this is the part that I usually say, now let's talk about our favorite design system, the Microsoft emojis. Some of you may actually not know that it actually started first as a design exploration into personal expression in virtual spaces. Due to the height of the pandemic, we were basically just trying to design these quirky characters using still the premise of the fluent design language. So as like shapes, materiality, textability, and scale, and create these versions of ourselves so that we didn't have to be on camera. Now, while that was happening, another effort into personal expression was the emojis, and Microsoft looked at the current system that was at the time and realized that, I guess, they weren't really speaking to the fluent design system that is so beautiful and expressive. So after several months, conversations, really great conversations into every single symbol, its story, its meanings and hidden meanings, recreated this rainbow, this collection of rainbow of little icons, over 2,000 little icons that are super expressive. And there's something to be said about design systems that I feel like films sometimes may have a little bit of a hard time grasping, which is this idea that icons and emojis, they can merge. They can transform. They can become something different in other formats. They can be applied to different screens in different formats. An emoji can become a text message to someone that you love, or a friend or family member. An emoji can be an email, a tweet, or an X, as we call it these days. An emoji can be a virtual space or part of a virtual space. It can be so many things. And during the creation of these emojis, As you see on the right side of this slide, there were a lot of perfect shapes that were used, perfect circles, semicircles, rounded squares, and rounded rectangles. As on the left side here, one thing that we always like to point out is that on the smiley structure, the outside shape is built with what we like to call the imperfect circle, sort of alluding to us humans, how we are imperfect creatures. And I could really keep going on and on about how they are beautifully built in this way with perfect shapes and therefore rendered through a flat camera, which makes them look like icons and symbols. But because this conversation, this presentation, it's all about behind the scenes, I really would like to talk about the stories behind these symbols. As it was a joy to make the dancing grandma, it was also to make like a little bell, a little hotel bell, from its sketch to its inception to its modeling, shading, texturing, animation, and finally rendering, as well as the film that celebrated all of these emojis. And within all of these stories, there is really a special one that I'd like to share with you all today. Right after the creation of the 2,000 and so symbols, we went into this other smaller design sprint, which was all about themes of inclusion, hybrid work mode, and accessibility. So at that time, Microsoft came to us to perhaps 5-10 ideas. We were supposed to also pitch 5-10 ideas. And this was also at the height of the pandemic. And I remember some of my favorite ones were the mom and the dad holding their baby, going to another Teams call. And for those of you who are parents and have gone through the pandemic, you certainly know what I'm talking about. Or perhaps, like some of us may have done, dressed up only the waist up to that other Teams call. But actually, one of my favorite icons is this little one here. And that's the one that has a personal story to me. So for that, first and foremost, meet my older brother, Luis Fernando. So Luis Fernando is the oldest sibling out of 4 siblings, all born from a Brazilian mom and dad. They all live in Brazil. I'm the only one spearheading things at Tendril Toronto. And Luis is one of my personal heroes. Mostly because Luis, when he was 19 years old, he had a tough fall that basically made him paralyzed from the waist down. But throughout my brother's life, throughout his 20s, 30s, and 40s. My brother actually had a chicken farm in Minas Gerais and a fish farm. My brother had rode horses. My brother had a motorcycle that I saw in his garage. My brother was riding a bicycle on the weekends with his partner. And if you ask what's the latest hobby of my brother, is scuba diving, which looks or sounds totally random from looking at all these activities, but besides riding a bicycle, those are all things that I have personally never done or had in my life. So back to the story of the emojis, when Microsoft had these 5-10 ideas and we were supposed to pitch 5-10 ideas, I couldn't help but think about or remember one of the fondest memories of my brother, which was when I was very little in Brazil and there was a celebration in the family, whether it was, you know, a wedding or a party. My brother will take the wheelchair and he wouldn't just go to the corner of the room. He would actually go to the middle of the dance floor and tilt the chair backwards just about 45 degrees and stay on that like swing angle to what I would describe it was the best dance move ever created. So because of all that, I pitched this idea to Microsoft, which kindly you said yes, and there it was born, the dancing wheelchair person. Now, it's within this passion, it's within this care and this backstory that I do believe that it actually helped us to land a pencil with the DNAD Awards last year. It's really thinking about these emojis, not just as symbols, but the careful messages that they can carry and empower the messages of others. And as I'm telling the story of my brother, I'm also trying to say that this can really also help so many that are out there that need these symbols to empower their own messages. And after that, we at Tendril, we also love to track the outcomes. And luckily we received some outcome from you that in fact, there's quite a bit of an exposure. There's 280 million monthly active users using emojis. In fact, I believe that 1 in every 5 messages contains emojis in the world. So right after that, that was a small sprint that was led by Sam Condal and Dustin Brown, who's just next to me. This is not scripted. And they sent us this like little sketch. And in this sketch, it was a question, came with a question. Can we make custom emojis? So can we exchange eyes, exchange the mouth and its exterior shapes? So what we did is that we said, okay, let's research that. So we took a small sample of 6 symbols. And first we just made a matrix of all of its combinations and permutations. And then we right away went into Cinema 4D, and this is just a proof of concept where we're playing this in, this is a live recording of the file, playing the animation live, where we can change its accessories, hats, emotions, and its exterior shape. So the beginning of the yes started to come out. Now, of course, under the hood, or should I say behind the scenes, there's a lot that goes into it. There was a lot of Python coding, a lot of node-based connections to make all of that a possibility. But the outcome of putting that hard work in is that we were able to then export 50 new emoji combinations in under 1 hour. And I think that if we were to talk about in the traditional sense, just designing, sketching, everything that I've mentioned before, it would easily take us 1.5 to 2 weeks to make 50 new custom emojis. So once again, there are so many backstories. It is such to have this chance to work on this project with you. And now I'm just going to let Yvel take over and talk to us about the future of our collaboration.
Well, thank you, Leo. Speaking of new ideas and the future of collaboration, perhaps I can touch on the prevailing topic that occupies perhaps a lot of our lives is AI and Copilot, which have now well and firmly landed in our lives. So the discussion around the impact of such technology and the ethical implications are all encompassing and far reaching. Basically, everyone's affected. And at the same time, the capability of this technology is awesome and it becomes exponentially better with time. In any case, we at Tendril are obviously actively researching and exploring how we can intersect with this brave new world. And what it all development, but then we're also actively investigating how we can leverage this amazing tool in our design practice. But today, because we are nerds in design, I'd like to focus on our most recent exploration on how AI can be visualized and expressed, because diving deep on that other topic might take another whole week, if I'm being honest. We noticed, I personally noticed that there's a real need to communicate to the wider world the amazing capabilities of AI as a powerful tool helping us in our day-to-day lives. Less as a tastemaker or definer of style or communication. Last year we had a number of brands approach us with a brief to help them communicate their latest achievements in this field, with a positive outlook and inspiring vision. And it's been really interesting to see how many facets of AI can be and how the major and minor players in the field are positioning themselves. And applying our usual process, we started to have a look at the much broader aspects of AI and where the touch points are in the world at large, and specifically how those interactions are designed. What is the message that people are receiving? Is it clear? Is it positive? Why are they scared? Are we reading too many sci-fi novels? Well, in any case, basically what we're asking is, what are the design concepts that can help us convey the capability of this technology along with its benefits? What are the colors, the shapes, and design tropes that we can leverage? And my God, we explored, and there was so much to explore, from visualizing how stable diffusion works, for instance, or depicting the image analysis grid. We tried, and also how language and word connections can be visualized. Or even how...
115.
Or even how the hardware can be shown off. And also to exploring anthropomorphic expressions of AI with emotive states. This one was a particularly interesting one because it started with a question and as a bit of a mystery, because all that we knew was that we were engaging in a design exercise to create avatars or entities that can convey a set of emotions according to user input. And yeah, I mean, we dove in, we sketched many, many, many different versions, trying to visualize what shapes and forms of this mysterious character could take, boiling it down to even the minimal amount of elements needed to make it emotive. A very interesting exercise, you should try that. And little do we know that it was something more along the lines of trying to give a face to a segment of the Copilot initiative, a very experimental one to be sure, and also by far the most interesting and fun one from last year. And along the way, I have to say that one thing that really dawned on us was that the people, most of the people behind this technology, the creators and the designers, all just really wanted to make the world a better place, a more accessible and more capable world. Well, that was my impression, at least, but you need to tell me perhaps later on. And I mean, but one thing that like what this really highlighted was that the importance of keeping in mind the human element in that design expression of AI, because at the end of the day, the human input is and remains the original spark of it all. And thus, during a bit of a pre-holiday downtime, we took it upon ourselves to explore how we might unpack all of the previously mentioned notions as a feature of the Microsoft ecosystem. And we kicked off a small design sprint into visualizing the AI and the substrate for the Copilot. You might recognize this. We started off with some keywords because we needed to find some concepts and themes that set out the vibe of what Copilot can be, at least for us as we saw it. Concepts such as chaos into order, autonomous, humanizing technology, or gigantic data integrations.
Wow.
Thank you. and we continued to take those keywords and also flesh out how the most important qualities should look and feel. Basically, the tonality and the texture of what these keywords can be. And these kind of resulted in these references here. So from the Microsoft core layer to all the way to visions of various substrate elements. And taking these references, it really helped us to jump into designing how the various components of this concept can behave. For instance, here, we tried to visualize how data can surface in an AI environment or as a tapestry of fine data points, or even as an iconography system that surfaces upward, pushing through an infinite floor. All in all, to say is that these were really interesting explorations and discoveries that went beyond the usual illustrations of blinking lights and networks of particles that we see quite often, and all to show that basically, if you take the time to invest into design explorations, it really allows us to find new visual metaphors and new tropes that can be feel quite fresh and helpful for the next project. And this is something that's happening at Tendril all the time. And, it makes me think that as AI takes over prediction, we humans might do less of the prediction judgment and routine decision making, and taking these wise words of a very smart person here to heart, we might want to focus more on the ideas and the visual feasting of it all. And I'm truly excited about where we can take things and the boundaries we can push here together. Hope to see you soon on the next one. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.